Good afternoon. It's a big personal pleasure and I think an important day in our lecture series. And I would like to introduce Juan Carlos Sancho and Sol Madridejos, SMAO, Sancho Madridejos Architecture Office. They're based in Madrid. Juan Carlos is an academic, he's a practitioner, a full professor in the School of Madrid. He was my teacher. Sol is a professor in a European University in Madrid, and both have been teaching and lecturing all over the place. And it's a very special lecture because other than their practice that I'm sure you are aware of and their built project that they are going to share with us, I wanted them to share with us their research that they have been working through it in the last actively in the last 25-30 years since I was a student in the school in Madrid. So I'm going to read a text that I wrote 25 years ago. 25 years ago that I recovered. This was for a publications of their work in El Croquis and in other books that have edited and printed their work. But I recovered it just to remember what I said when I was recently graduated, and to see if these reflections are still valid. I think this is relevant because research in architecture is a very mutable practice and goes from one side to another. It's very difficult to maintain a coherence and a, let's say, a, almost an obsessive and insistent idea, searching the goal of an intellectual, I would say, almost impossible goal. And that kind of transit, that itinerary, is what drives a lot of research practice like Sancho Madridejos. So these reflections are about mathematics and geometry, a yield of harvest of formulas that are only logical symbols for what is real. Formulas whose scope does not extend to the description of mystery. In contrast, creativity derived from intuition suggests unexpected relationships and encourages the guess at abstract relations. There are two lines of creativity, one that comes directly from reason, and the other one that is derived from the architect's sensibility. Both are separated in their case in a very instructive way, and it has been also separated in the 20th century. They are concentrated in few examples which transcend intellectual postulates, techniques, local expressions, and movements, so they can freely commit themselves to the creative tasks in real operations. These examples possess not only the truth, but also the supreme beauty, a cold, austere beauty, an attractive to the weakest part of our nature, but capable of decided perfection and pure to the extent of being almost sublime, as only the greatest art can be. Sancho Madridejos' architecture has an intellectual core and an expressive exterior. The solid relationship between the two means and their architectural development bases its experiences and lines of research towards positions that are developed in series. We will see some of those today. These series are also vectors which guide their strategy for to develop new spatial models. The division into series of projects used by the creators to arrange and organize their work offers a chronological and thematic view of their concern and opens new paths that are being developed into methods. The type of abstraction that is used in their architecture is very deep in nature, but once the spatial model has been formalized, it is possible to obtain interesting practical results that become a design method. Sancho Madridejo's works clearly seek to be expressive, and this makes it possible for them to create by using a simple set of rules that they have established in advance, and whose utility is derived from finding a physical object that satisfies the method's requirements. This model is not like those of other sciences, and though it is based on auxiliary experience from other arts, progresses in what is auxiliary and leads to perfection of what is basic, thus establishing a deep relationship between expressiveness and architecture on a solid intellectual base. I was, I would say, a privileged spectator of the research process when it started, and it resulted in the Chapel of Argiasteron that we will hopefully see tonight. A process that was developed as a result of a close look at the history of art, an active position in contemporary concerns, and the architect's personal and intellectual relationship with Chillida, which confirmed their questions and led their career towards the development of systems to explore architectural space. One important thing that they've learned from Chillida was the value of slowness as a constant feature in their creative and artistic work. The slowness is essential for the setting and maturation of the contemporary findings. So that are so rapidly installed in the cultural memory by the media and which suppose a very high risk of personal requirements that only be detrimental to the development of the original ideas. Architecture may be hindered rather than helped by stylistic theoreticians and certain positions that acquire their actors for the absurd current identification and individuality. The chapel stands out as a mother structure, appearing as a simplified outline that already dwells into architectural setting as a topological manifestation. It belongs to their classic phase, which was developed toward greater complexity in other projects like the Church in Pinto and the Meditation Pavilion in Shanghai and other projects that we will see tonight, which are permutations of this series of folds that the architects used to incorporate as new spatial variables and new materials. The chapel does not correspond to an objective canon of laws or procedures derived from traditional aesthetics, and its spatial conception means reveals itself as something inert that attains significance under the light without requiring any further imaginary. Contemplation of the complex and unitary space is the most evocative reference of the sacred. The shapes lack intrinsic meaning, though we may subconsciously guess associations with artistic models and references that stimulates our imagination and confronts the values of the creative system that was used. This creative system is their justification and represents the scientific skeleton of your architecture, the structural lines that could be logically deducted as the trail left by the points in space where they move, releasing the folded planes from their potent geometry and totally destabilizing formed conceptions of how to handle space. The Sancho Madridejo's design is clearly under the Le Corbusier tradition of boxes, but they cross this frontier to construct increasingly complex structures comparable to unitary systems that conclude on a compact space. Its nature is free, and if interpreted as a style or symbol, it can be understood as elaboration of an abstract representation, continuous according to a rational scheme, and finite as a solved problem. Thus, the relationship binding together the parts of its complex geometry envelops a space that builds a topological structure. That proposition, obtained in the Ballesteron Chapel and the group of houses and pavilions, using their methodology, forms a set in its absolute diversity, a framework restricted of its own references, where the same unfolds its differences. The ideas developed give rise to the individuality of the pieces, keeping with open and dynamic positions in counterpoint in the spatial events, which occur in a dissonant polyphony that seeks to make the design space conceptually transparent and developing them from within, showing how different in its form the exterior is by making the superficial duality of the fold appear as inflection, limit, and transition from space to form in a topological unity. Please welcome Juan Carlos Sancho and Sol Madridejos to MIT. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the presentation. And I want to thank the MIT School of Architecture for the invitation. Today, I am going to explain our research around certain ideas that have been of interest to us over the years, ideas that have been deepened through a large number of proposals, documents, reflections, classes, and conferences, as well as the constructed work that is the final objective of the process. All of these architectural approaches weave a fabric that allows a series of concrete, elaborate, and defined projects to emerge, some of which have finally been constructed or are in the process of being so. Initial themes such as the void, the fold, or tone of space have been developed, blended with one another, made more complex, or eventually given place to new themes. Today, we are focused mainly on the theme of the fold, from the very beginning to the development process, and their interaction with other themes as a means of giving place to more complex projects and different ways of approaching the world of folding. We will start by quickly showing you the room in the Spanish Pavilion in the 2012 Biennale of Venice, where our work was exhibited because it was, in a sense, a revision of our previous research process. In the exhibition, we somehow relocated a part of our office, of the world in which we are immersed, which is why we decided to select and include 100 small models of the process of different phases of the work inside a 13-foot exhibit, as well as the small research models, a 1-to-4 model of a dome that we were working on, which will soon be constructed, hangs suspended over the room. The choice of models, the study of how they relate to one another, and the project resulting from them were for us an opportunity for reflection and advancement through the visible organization of some of our work accumulated over the last few years. As I said at the start, I would like to speak mainly about the theme of the fold in our work. But before showing you our work, I want to give you a small introduction to explain our understanding of the fold within the multiple meanings and applications that the term has today in the world of architecture. This theme alone could be the subject of a class or even an entire course. But today, I only want to make a small introduction in relation to certain aspects that have been of interest to us throughout history. The fall has been historically present within the world of art, even though the way it has been used and understood has evolved and changed over the centuries. Initially, as we can see in this image of the winged Vitruvius Amathrace on the left, the classic fall was used as a medium to express a structure, that is a human body in this case, and everything that affects it, such as wind, water, or movement. The fall here is a means of explaining other variables. In the 16th century, Leonardo da Vinci, as we can see on the right, used the fall in a similar way, like the result of a system, a global system capable of expressing an artificial fabric as much as the structure of a body, the movement of the air or hair, the swirls of the water. Fall still continues to have a direct relation with the form that it gives structure to. However, in Bernini's Ecstasy of Saint Teresa, there is a fundamental change. The fall breaks away from the body to express an idea instead. In this case, lightness. The fall, despite being made in heavy marble, helps to express the idea of lightness by generating an interior space that pushes the figure upwards, making it elevate with the counterpoint of the hand and foot down fall, and reinforce this sensation of lightness. The fall here no longer serves to give structure, rather it expresses an idea. Now, taking a leap in history, this small cubist guitar by Picasso on the left shows how the artist used folding to go from 2 to 3 dimensions, to space itself, using pieces of paper that, when folded, can create space. In the post-cubist chair that we can see on the right, also by Picasso, we can see a theme that we are especially interested in and will be resumed in our work, which is the theme of the unit. As you can see, Picasso, through a sole piece of folded metallic sheet, created a chair in 3 dimensions. We could say that from the 20th century onwards, the winged Vitruvius Amathrace, as a classic fold, transforms and divides itself. On the one hand, as an idea, like the expression of a concept. For example, in this winged Vitruvius of Amathrace by Pablo Palazuelo. On the other hand, as an object, like this dress by Issey Miyake, that releases itself from the body and no longer needs the human body to express itself. From the 20th century onwards, diverse artists have worked with the fold with the aim to express an idea of unity and continuity. An example of such an artist is Eduardo Chillida, who we had the opportunity to meet when we were very young. He was the first one who spoke to us about this idea. Being able to speak to him about these themes was for us a first approach, a discovery of something that we knew could be taken to the architectural field with media belonging specifically to architecture. Something that nobody had done at that point in time. Moreover, Gilles Deleuze speaks of 2 types of completely different folds, the internal or organic fold and the external or inorganic fold. The internal fold is that which is produced in nature as a result of internal movement of material. This type of movement is reflected in mathematical formulae made by René Thom. Some architects have been inspired. Yeah. Ah. Some architects. Yes, okay. No. Some architects have been inspired by this type of fold for their work, and consequently used it. But this isn't the kind of field that is of interest to us. On the contrary, our research is within the world of the external fold, where the work of Chillida, Richard Serra, or Oteiza, among others, finds itself. It involves faults produced by the behavior of an external voluntary tension, which makes the initial matter suffer a topological transformation, maintaining its unity. This is why we are interested in the fold, because of its ability to generate space from the unit, a unit that is as shaped and spatial as it is material and structural. We are now going to review the process we went through from the initial ideas to the constructed works. In order to do so, we will start with these five basic folds, each of which is used and developed through various works. Today we will see at least one project developed through one of each of these initial folds. The first corresponds with the chapel of Vallacerón, the first fold that we constructed. It is a box fold. The second is a free curve fold, which corresponds with the model of the Biennale of Venice. The third is a pleated fold that we use as a skin of a winery. Then a curve fold used like the void of a massive volume. And finally, also a curve fold, one that generates a unit of space. Within the work process, each and every one of the base fold is developed through a series of layouts and drawings, until the complete definition of the piece has been reached in terms of geometry and space. Let's begin with the first of the projects, the Chapel of Vallacerón. The procedure that was realized came from an initial fold of a flat unitary element that kept the unit intact or folded. The result of the final shape depends on the transformation that occurred. In this case, the transformation of the flat element. This chapel promotes the box fold, a unitary box in which the fold served to resolve the problem of continuity from the initially prismatic box, and with the fold as a starting point, a series of projections are realized in the volume until the final formation of the box is reached. This unit is both formed and spatial, as well as material and structural, as the mechanic behavior of the chapel is based on the geometry of the form. The form itself makes the volume structurally stable, achieving a unitary volume that doesn't require added element to sustain itself. The variables of reality that intervene in the process need to be added to these initial premises, such as the landscape, the surrounding area, as well as the light, the scale, material, and measurement. Variables that are incorporated into the project while defining it. Finally, as a preliminary step before the construction, we work on the concrete definition of the project, which is a lot easier to control today thanks to the new programs and possibilities of computers. But it wasn't so evident a few years ago when this small building was made. Now we are going to take a little walk around the constructed chapel. It is located within a vast hunting ranch in an elevated point that can be accessed through a path that goes around the piece and allows one to see it from different angles. Reinforced concrete was used as a material to express the unity that we were looking for, as this was the only material used for the roof, the walls, and the floor, completed only by the window panes that at that time disappear, allowing transparency of the interior, while materializing at other times, reflecting the sky and the environment. Once in the interior, the space is closed and tranquil, with only two elements acting as a counterpoint, the cross and a small chapel opening to the east. This continuous space, which comes from the uniform light, is broken by the light from the west, which acts as another pane that breaks the form. From the interior, one's gaze goes back to the landscape outside that is very present in the interior, as an attempt to unite the fold and nature, an element that also forms an important part of the building. Within the line of work initiated by the chapel, we wanted to analyze the relationship between the form of the fold, its size, and its capacity for resistance, as a means of working out the optimum size that a folded form should have in order to sustain itself. The chapel is situated under the optimum limit, meaning that it could have had a larger size without added elements being required to sustain it. In a church in Pinto, near Madrid, we wanted to find the optimum point of equilibrium from the three variables and therefore developed a project that consisted of the largest possible size. But we were also interested in exploring the possibilities of exceeding this limit and deciding how to work in such circumstances. This is how we came to propose the project in Qingpu Church in China. Here, the fold is not the only element, but rather an independent metal cover that rests on a reinforced concrete U that sustains the fold of the roof. The two side walls are glass panels open to the surrounding area, since the church is situated between a canal and a park. The complex also have living spaces, a dining room and meeting rooms that form a courtyard for worshippers who want to spend the day together. One can appreciate the differentiation between the frame of the roof and the width of the piece of concrete that sustains it. And a plan of the construction design in China to explain its execution. As well as the definition plans, we decided to make this model in China, including every possible detail to facilitate the understanding and construction of it. Here are some images of the interior of the temple. Continuing with another of the base folds that we saw earlier, I'm now going to explain the winery in Ciudad Real in Spain, which we work on for the possibilities of pleating. The process that you can see above on the left serves to create a skin that gives thickness and scale to the volume of the winery, a skin capable of reflecting light, colors, and the changing tones on the environment, granting perspective qualities in continuous transformation. The winery is located in a ranch of vineyards in rustic surroundings, where a series of parallel superimposed natural elements that make up the landscape and scenery, such as a small hill at the bottom, a group of 100-year-old oak trees, and the grapevines that follow a north-south axis. This series of elements are countered by the path that runs through the whole ranch. The winery building is placed at the end of the path, as if it were an extra parallel element with a hill as a backdrop. At once in this interior, the building returns toward a scenery, dominating and framing it, as we will see later on from the interior spaces. The wine production program required an optimized response with an industrial character. We decided to resolve it in the most simple and optimal way, by means of a linear piece embedded in the slope of the terrain. A concrete base in the shape of a U was built into the land with a metal structure, above it wrapped by the light and pleated skin. This pleated outer skin is almost like an Issey Miyake dress. In terms of the organization of the spaces, two independent paths are separated. One for the production of wine, with access to the lower floor, and a linear distribution that is useful to all work areas, and the other with access from the semi-basement, going to the first floor where the reception and events rooms are situated. We are now going to take an exterior tour from the access path through to the winery piece. In these first images, the building appears to be surrounded by the landscape and scenery, the vines, the trees, and the hill. The possibility of working in this natural environment and the ability to use and activate the topographic, visual, and sensory qualities that we saw from the beginning has been decisive from the initial concept. The linear piece is only broken at two points: the lookout that opens up to the landscape, and the place of entry dug into the land, where the access is made through an atrium open to the landscape, framing it and giving it value, so that it's now perceived differently in relation to the constructed piece. In this atrium, the linear volume overhangs above the access space from which the transition between the interior and exterior emerges. Before beginning the tour of the indoor visitor spaces, I want to explain the relationship between the main fields and the path. An exterior gallery allows the simultaneous vision of the atrium and the cask room located on the other side. From this point, there is access to a small shop space, reception, and wine tasting area that connects to the visitor top floors. On the other side of the gallery, there is a cask room, a fundamental piece of the production of wine. The gallery also generates a longitudinal path that crosses the entire first floor of the building in a spatial continuity. Here, the folds are used like an element of union and relation between different spaces, producing continuity between the exterior gallery and the main wine tasting and events room. The relationship between the landscape and the value of it from the construction is always present through openings that frame the scenery and offer partial vision of nature. The scenic viewpoint projects towards the outdoor area, dominating the view of the vineyards. And to finish off the tour of the interior, here is an image of the wine production rooms and the upper promenade for visitors. As I said, a main theme of the project has been the way the metallic skin responds to the scenery. The pleating of this skin that reflects the colors and tones of the surrounding landscape and the changes that occur within it over time was an idea that arose from one of the possibilities of pleating forms relating to our work. This facade is perforated in the main entrance with shapes of birds that fly into the interior, reflecting light in a mobile way throughout the day. The back facade is only used for the production of wine in certain parts of the years. Here, work entrances from the upper level are generated through these sculptured doors, which are integrated into the facade. When opened, they remind us of the continuity between the interior and the exterior, making the presence of the landscape evident once more. Architecture lives in the landscape, it completes it and integrates with it. Within the evolution of our research around the fold, we are currently working on curved folds as an expression of the tension of the fold, where the form is the result of the external tension being applied. This process allows the support to be transferred, freeing the space below the roof. Contrary to the classic domes that transmit the load vertically as a result of compression, the process released with the fold allows us to work with very fine sheets that transmit the load laterally, allowing larger cantilevers that leave the space generated below the fold free. The work with the curved folds has given place to different types and different ways of using the fold in our projects. We are going to see some examples of the different types of curved folds, like a free unitary fold, a double fold, a fold as a void within a volume, or how they have been applied to our work with domes. The first of these is what we used for another small chapel, also in a huge private field. Here we can see an initial work in a model of this chapel that opens up to the scenery through an outdoor atrium. Within the process of definition of the curved folds, there are geometric control through parameterization is a necessary step that helps define the complete geometry of the piece as well as the optimization of its construction. This work acts as a tool that allows information to be transferred to all of the participants of the execution process to reach the final result. Other types of drawings, like these ones that we can see in the image, serve to explain the piece on a conceptual level through different definitions. In parallel, the model also advances, introducing new variables as it does so. Against the initial models made with poster board and therefore without thickness, new models are necessary in order to include the real thickness, the definition of the knots and joints, as well as the scale and characteristic of the materials. This chapel has a total height of 33 feet, exactly the same as the chapel of Vallacerón. And the material used will also be reinforced concrete, as it is a material capable of expressing unity and the continuity of the piece. This final image reflects its location in the landscape, in a clearing of the tree field area. We're now going to quickly look at an example of the double fold. It arises from the process of topological transformation that you can see in the image, where the straight fold and the curved fold function simultaneously, influencing each one in the definition of the other. The final result is materialized in this building for the multi-use pavilion where a unitary space is generated. The next project that we are going to see is the Circle of Art and Technology of Segovia in Spain, where one of the themes treated is the use of the fold as a void within a huge volume. There are a lot of examples in history that have always been of great interest to us, like this one we see in the images, where an exterior void is created, generating a space in a compact volume. But in our project, as we saw before, the folded form allows us to transmit the weight laterally, making the dome float above the entry space of the building. This project came from a competition for a plot on the peripheries of the historical city of Segovia. It involved an isolated piece of land off a main road that unites the entrance of the city of Madrid with the urban center of Segovia. The master plan of the whole process was realized by David Chipperfield, who defined the starting points of all of the buildings that make up the area. The entirety of the buildings are organized around three squares, which are connected to the exterior through pedestrianized streets. The part that we developed as winners of the competition included three buildings situated around the first of the squares that has been constructed. It has a knowledge center, an enterprise center, and an arts center. The base of the master plan required very concrete conditions. Firstly, each building was clearly defined in a volume, whereby each of their vertices was fixed in the space. These initial prismatic volumes were the starting point of our projects. Furthermore, it was also necessary to create a porch on the ground floor, surrounding the square and creating a transition between the indoor and outdoor spaces. We are interested in the possibilities of projecting three independent buildings that make up a unit and give form to an open exterior space, like the square that sits between them. Therefore, we have decided to treat the three projects as one, creating a relationship between the three buildings and the exterior space of the square. Using this as an initial premise, we propose to generate two points of tension in the square. The first would be a sheltered atrium with access to the knowledge center in front of the main entrance of the premises. And the second point of tension would be through the curved fold as an element of attraction, situated as access to the enterprise center, which is the first building that has been built, and the only one for the moment. These two points of tension work as spaces of transition between the outside and the inside, consistent with the doorways and the interior public spaces in the building. Now we will look at the building for the Enterprise Center. This building, just like the other two buildings, emerges from the total compact volume defined by the master plan. From this initial piece, a series of processes and transformations are realized, maintaining the edges that limit the volume, whilst giving place to the final formation of the building. The first and main action which is realized is the inclusion of the fold, which is integrated into the constructed volume. One biconic dome is generated from a similar process that we carried out with the previous fold, whereby the geometry is defined by the law of the fold. This dome is integrated into the total volume, creating a void in the piece, a dome floating above the front atrium. A series of interior vaults give continuity from the atrium to public spaces on the ground floor of the building. This enterprise center is allocated to shared workspaces for various companies specializing in new technologies. In the interior organization comes from the overlap of two differentiated uses. The ground floor and first floor consists of a communal area, exhibitions, conference rooms, and shared offices. It is in this first block that the public space containing the vault is located. The two upper floors are allocated to private enterprise modules. Each of these two floor modules gained light from two opposite facades, one from the street or the square in a double height space, and the other through a courtyard gallery above that is excavated in the volume. The concrete use for the vaults as well as the dome had to be made from a specific highly technological concrete. It was a thixotropic sprite concrete which we investigated during the previous process up to the final test in the vaults prior to the construction of the more complex piece, the dome. This is the final result of the vaults. Following the work process that we pointed out earlier, the complete definition in terms of geometry also demands a parameterization that helps to control the base condition of the fold and allows its final construction. This geometrical control of the piece allows a precise mechanized construction process in which every element should be completely defined beforehand. We can see different phases of the construction of the formwork of the dome and the positioning of the armatures. And finally, the concreting, which was the crucial point, since the final result depended on this moment. The entire surface of the dome was made in the same day, but with half the thickness, to avoid joints and other complications. The second layer was added the following day until the necessary thickness was achieved. The decisive moment of the removal of the formwork finally arrived, a process that, as you can see, lasted many days, while our expectation grew. In the end, it was a success. On the other side of the atrium, the dome is visible in the coffee courtyard. It is possible to walk alongside the dome over the curved stairs which connect the outdoor spaces of the different floors. This is the final result of this courtyard. We are now going to look at some images of the final piece taken from different angles, such as the total volume that opens towards the square. The two upper floors have a double glazed skin with serigraph, allowing great interior lighting in an optimum and sustainable manner with the use of special sunscreen glass. The interior of the building is not yet finished, so we will only look at images of the exterior. Another one of the buildings of this complex is the center of artistic creation, a place for the creation and exhibition of art linked to new technologies. It is therefore an evolving building where the actual works of artists can transform both the skin of the building as well as the interior spaces. From the point of view of the interior organization, we have created this building with a double spatial system. On the one hand, a system of galleries in the shape of a cross, and on the other, a series of independent rooms, each of one with its special with a special unit. The galleries above have both a connection and display function. They surround all of the exhibition areas, connecting every one of the different rooms. Each of the rooms consists of a themed and spatial unit, like the one that houses this concrete suspended dome. It is a curved fold above a free space of 100 by 100 feet. It is a model of this dome that was exhibited in Venice. This dome is situated above the more compromised room in terms of form, located next to the entry and with a great central space that links the display area to the basement. Here, every artist will have the chance to work in it and transform it as they see fit. To finish, we are briefly going to look at some images of the other project, the LAX project, in which the theme of the fold also overlaps and blends with other architectural concepts and spaces, the Business School in Madrid, a project that we are currently working on. It consists of a creation of a new campus in a terrain where a building for the same use already exists. Our proposal involves integrating new uses required from learning spaces and the auditorium, while also reorganizing the treating the campus facilities. We have placed the new buildings in a way that generates an open green space between the different constructed elements. as a means of creating a connection between them. The program is clearly differentiated into two independent uses. On the one hand, it integrates classroom, offices, meeting room, etc. And on the other hand, the use of the auditorium for 1,000 people with an independent function. From these premises, we propose to construct two separate and independent buildings connected through a covered exterior space, another atrium, which in this case organizes the connection and flow of the campus. This atrium becomes the point of call and reference and the center of campus activity. Again, a dome, in this case made of stone, like the rest of the buildings, qualifies the exterior space and acts as a connection between the main public space of both buildings, the lobbies and the auditorium, in which we use the fold again as a means of generating the dome. And finally, here we have the exterior image of the campus, which marks the end of today's speech. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Sol. This was an extraordinary class, lecture. And I want to open questions to our community.
How do you or what are the methods you're using to resolve issues of thickness at points where the folds are intersecting?
Sorry, because I don't speak English, and my voice is. I prefer speaking Spanish.
Generally, geometry provides a zero thickness. In terms of inserting into a building code, we have to provide a certain thickness for its constructability. But topologically and mathematically, the geometry that is needed to acquire the equilibrium is zero.
Twenty centimeters.
That's a coded thickness, okay? Because everything is organized to get rid of the thickness as a material need, because the geometry and the topology of the structure provides that. That's a recreation of the 20 centimeters. Okay? Another question?
Extend the same question. I think the question was about, and I'm very interested in knowing how they solve the actual thickness, because the problem is, I guess what he. So the problem is that something that could be done in one thickness, zero thickness, will be very difficult to solve in 20 centimeters thickness.
Sí.
That's part of the process. They start working in zero thickness sheet of paper models, constructions. And one of the most the variables that appear during the process of developing it is the thickness, of course. So suddenly they start working with other models because of the thickness, the points start being transformed. And the geometry transforms to maintain its condition of being a point. No, in English is very well.
Yeah, yeah.
Of the thickness.
There is a optimum relationship. These three buildings could be more bigger, the chapel. This is perfect in the thing, the tamaño.
The size. Scale, dimension.
We are explaining more or less very, very quickly, already very fast.
So, in other words, there's a strict relationship between the form of the given by the geometry, the resistance of it, and the scale and the constructive scale given by the thickness. In unstable. So you have to displace the two points of the vertex to provide the ultimate desired geometry.
If the other hand, this point has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 planes together
in monolithic condition.
Thank you very much for your lecture. The work is very interesting. My question is following on this question of thickness. And in this folded language that you're using, Would you be interested at all in thinking about different materials other than concrete? For example, folded steel. We've seen with the pat cows folded wood structures. They're a little bit smaller, but also with this one fold technique. Would that be of interest to you?
There are two ideas in this kind of folds. Two ideas very important. One, the unity, the continuity. The continuity, the effort.
The stresses.
The stress tensions. Continuity. Or work like a whole, unity of all. The concrete is the perfect material for that
we need.
Mechanical way, mechanical way, because you perform. The other one, for example,
Richard Serra.
Steel. Richard Serra. Bending moment.
This is different. Thank you for the presentation. It was really great. I have a question about the idea of the fold, and you've demonstrated many ways of working with it formally. And I'm curious if this also impacts the way that you understand context, or if there's other ways of folding beyond the materiality and the spatial effects of that.
Fold like idea is very, very complex. There are a lot of folds. This is a kind of fold where the unity is very important. But
there are a lot of kinds of work to work in like folds. Right now, there are the software very good to work in software about folds. Folding, but in this case only interest nos interesa.
They are interested in the structural and the geometrical unity.
For example, in this case.
These algorithms.
Some are very popular because you can make a lot of projects like this. A bar, this bar, like some algorithms result is kind of works. These are good because it's other kind.
Yeah. He's insisting that it's not a formal exercise or a formal effect what they are searching of, but to acquire that moment of equilibrium and of unity that puts together the mechanic performance and the geometries as a spatial response.
Are more complex. We can explain every project from different points of view, different perspective, and explain other variables that intervene in the project. There are a lot of complexity of the context, the many the program, the cost, the many things that are very important. Also, in the chapel, for example, is only a unit. It's very simple project. There are no program, no light, no water, no nothing. But in other projects, the program or the characteristic of the la normativa, the code, yeah, different things that intervene and make the project more complex. Yes.
These are part of an essay they wrote with Chigida, where he was somehow explaining this ambition of acquiring the unity. You know, the unit is always there, and Chigida has been a great inspiration, not only in the formal aspects or material aspects, but in the conceptual approach to space in all their careers since the long research has been being developed. This text is 30 years, no?
Yes.
30 years, I remember. Yeah? Yeah, it was published in El Croquis.
Thanks for the talk. I'm curious conceptually for you how important it is that it's foldable from a single one piece of paper as opposed to maybe connecting two pieces or more.
Dice que qué importancia le dais a la idea de que una sola hoja sea capaz de generar el pliegue o hacerlo a través de la conexión de dos hojas que hacen.
La cartulina en ese tamaño se aproxima mucho a la realidad, por eso la utilizamos, no porque sea origami, algo que vamos cambiando.
He's saying that they're using in their process the folded paper, no? For its practicity of responding to the reality of the space easily, no? But there's nothing against operating with dual folds or dual unitarian system that coincide.
For example, here the piece of paper is for the dome only, but there are the vaults in the interior that are another things that are connecting with the dome. It's the continuity of the dome in the interior, but the paper which is folded is only for the dome. Is no, is, there are different folding pieces. No, no sé si esa es la pregunta. Sí. Si se entiende.
Any other question? Well, Sancho Madridejos, Juan Carlos Sansol. Thank you very much for your presentation.